Why do you try? I'm serious, why do you bother to do anything? Unless you single-handedly manage to cause the singularity, in which case, I really don't want to know you. In the big picture, nothing you do, or we do, is ever going to matter. So why do we even bother? Why doesn't the entire human race just lie down and wait to die? Because motivation.
You know, Shane, that'd be a great intro if, you know, it wasn't the same one used on your wiki page.
Timmy, shut up. Motivation is defined as anything that initiates, guides, and maintains goal-oriented behaviors. As I like to say, it's anything that makes you do stuff.
If nothing motivated us, it would result in us just standing around every day doing nothing. Something motivates us to do everything, so be it productive, entertaining, or just plain stupid.
I believe!
Hi,
I win! Fourth take in a row! Anyways, what's up?
The script told me to introduce the 5 theories of motivation. Instinct theory?
Anish, you had one job!
Okay, the 5 theories of motivation are, in order, instinct theory,
drive reduction theory,
incentive theory,
optimal arousal theory,
and Maslow's pyramid or hierarchy of needs. Let's get started.
Instinct theory.
As the name implies, instinct theory claims that everything you do is because of your instincts.
Instincts are defined as innate, typically fixed patterns of behavior across certain species in response to certain stimuli. In other words, it's behaviors that are inborn and consistent across entire species.
An example of an instinct would be running away from snakes, which is considered one because it is inborn and consistent throughout entire species.
Running from frogs, on the other hand, isn't an instinct because it's not inborn and it's not consistent, at least for us, humans.
The theory goes that instincts were developed over the course of human evolution. As early humans lived, those with good instincts survived and passed on their genes and instincts to their offspring, whereas those without good instincts didn't survive. Over time, we end up with the set of instincts we have today. Here's an example. I'm going to trap Timmy in a forest.
Dude, there's like 2 trees. Can you just screen me in or something?
As I was saying, Timmy has been trapped in there for quite some time.
Yeah. It's been 7.8 seconds.
Timmy, shut up and play along. Anyways, arguably, one of the most fundamental human instincts is to socialize and be part of a group. As Timmy has been left alone for a long time now, his instincts are to go find some people, and therefore this motivates him to escape.
Wait, he's been trapped for hours in this forest. And the best excuse for him wanting to get out is because he's lonely.
Yes, it's instinct theories. Now stop interrupting.
Of course, we're humans, though. It's not that simple. We think.
Wait, what? People think?
I know, what a concept. The point is, we're not ruled by purely primitive instincts. We can make decisions, and as soon as that starts happening, instinct theory breaks down.
Which cheesily transitions us into...
Michael, where'd you come from?
Drive reduction theory.
If you've ever played The Sims before, you can relate to this.
Wait, you mentioned EA? Thou shalt not mention Electronic Arts, you!
Okay, Michael, The Sims 1 came out before EA got their heads stuck up their own.
And we are centering the rest of that line.
Anyways, in The Sims, your sim has needs represented by bars that go down over time. In order to keep your sim happy, you have to refill those bars.
Drive reduction theory works in the same way. You have drives that constantly build up and up, and you need to meet those drives so you can maintain homeostasis.
Here's an example. I'm going to trap Shing in the forest this time.
Gee, this is terrible.
He's been going without food and water and been there for hours.
Okay, you weren't playing along for my segment, so I'm not playing along for yours.
Pretend Shing's been in the forest for hours. He's starving so badly that he's willing to eat anything, even...
Not happening. Just throwing that out there. The problem with drive reduction theory is it only explains fairly basic things. It doesn't deal with any more complicated human behaviors that don't directly deal with survival.
This brings us to...
incentive theory.
This is a very simple theory because one we all inherently understand.
It assumes that we do things because we are rewarded for it.
And that's about it! Michael.
How do you manage to BS four paragraphs about this on your wiki page?
It's a talent. So let's assume I want someone to help me comment all my code from my wiki page because I was a lazy developer who didn't bother at the time.
Not doing it no matter what you offer me.
It was gonna be good. Don't judge me.
Optimal arousal theory.
This theory works based on the premise of arousal.
The basic idea is that you need to try to keep your arousal level in its optimal zone, hence the name optimal arousal.
Too low of arousal level and you're bored.
Too high and you're completely stressed out. Optimal arousal theory states that we try to do activities that keep our level of arousal in its optimal zone, so that we're neither bored nor stressed. In essence, we're trying to live a, quote, balanced life. We all know how well that works out.
Here's an example. I'm going to lock Shing into class for a long period of time. And since he's not cooperating, we're going to actually do it.
Wait, what?
In you go!
Holy crap.
Shing's level arousal is far lower than his optimum levels, which means he's in a state of discomfort until the situation is remedied.
God, I swear, Timmy, I'm getting you back for that one. And finally, we have
Maslow's Hierarchy of Needs.
Maslow's pyramid was developed by Abraham Maslow in 1943.
As its name implies, it's a pyramid of needs, with basic ones at the bottom and more complex ones at the top.
The theory goes, if your needs down at the bottom aren't met, you lose interest in needs up top. In other words, you no longer are motivated to pursue them.
So first, you need to pursue physiological needs, like food or water.
Next comes safety, which is, well, the need to feel safe.
Following that are social needs, the need to be accepted and loved.
After that, lie esteem needs, self-esteem, achievement, competence, and independence.
And finally comes self-actualization, the need to live up to one's fullest potential.
Debatedly, there's another tier, self-transcendence, which is the need to find meaning and identity beyond the self, but that tier isn't consistent across the sources we've looked at.
Basically, the easiest way to make someone lose interest in something is to deprive them of water.
Exactly, and that's what we're going to do to Timmy today.
What are you talking about?
Let's go for a run.
A run?
Yep, but first, observe. We creep up on the wild Timmy in his natural habitat, in front of a computer. He is currently browsing the YouTubes. When offered water, he refuses, as he's in no shortage of this precious liquid. However, all of that is about to change.
I have a bad feeling about this.
See how long it takes you to run 3 miles.
3 miles.
Yes, get going.
Walking down the sidewalk, kicking my feet as I move on to the music, step to the beat. I woke up today, canceled all my plans, and I stepped right outside with my guitar in my hands, and the notes became a loud as a sound caressed the air, and I kicked it up a notch as I strolled without. I'm going down the road to a brand new place, and I'll get there with a smile on my face. Yeah, so lift me up. I'm moving on, singing and dancing while I play my song. Yeah, I'm having a good time, keeping it going. Come on, clap your hands and won't you sing along? And I was taking up high, give our dreams.
There is the exit. We are a third of the way through. You just finished your first mile. How do you feel? Keep going. 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 Keep going
successfully fail to meet Timmy's basic physiological requirements. We'll see him rapidly lose interest in the interwebs in an attempt to get one.
Timmy and I aren't. At this point, Timmy has run 3 miles. Now you have two options, Timmy. We can offer you an extremely entertaining YouTube video or a bottle of Dolly.
We're censoring that.
Yes, we are. Cut.
Well, and that's about it. Let's solve now.
Hey, where's Anish?
Yeah, who cares? Instinct theory says that we do everything because of our basic instincts. For instance, most humans require companionship.
I will christen you, Bob, and you will be my best friend.
Drive reduction theory states that we do things to satisfy our basic needs.
Let me use the bathroom!
Incentive theory says that we do things because there's a reward.
I smell cake! Let me out!
Optimal arousal theory says we do things to not be too stressed or not stressed enough.
Patty cake, baker's man. Bake me a cake as fast as you can!
And Maslow's pyramid says that when lower, more basic needs aren't met, you are no longer motivated to pursue higher goals.
I wonder if you can drink your own blood.
Yeah, so what do we do now?
We could just end the video really abruptly.
No one said it's going to be easy.
Let's face it, change is hard.
I'm here for you. You can do one more.
You're not alone. We can do this together.
You're my motivation.
You are my inspiration.
My driving force.
There's an idea for you. See yourself as an artist when you go to work every day. See yourself as someone who gets to create a masterpiece through your work regardless of what you do. I think every single one of us has a need for creative expression. We all have in our hearts a longing to go to work every day and to create. That's part of what makes us special. Actually, let me put it this way. We all have a creative longing to realize our potential. It's one of the most fundamental of all human hungers. How do you get there? Go to work every day. See yourself as an artist. Be brilliant at what you do. It makes you feel so good. Focus plus time equals genius. Most people, Edison was asked, you know, Edison is a fascinating guy. He had close to 2,000 patents in his life. He was asked, what's the secret of your genius? You know what he said? Most people get up every day. They do many things. I get up every day. I do a few. That is the secret of my mastery. Picasso one day was in a market, and a woman saw him. She said, Mr. Picasso, it's great to see you. I'm a huge fan. He said, nice to meet you. She said, Mr. Picasso, she pulled out a piece of paper and a pencil. Mr. Picasso, can you do a little piece of art for me? Can you do a little drawing? He said, absolutely. Did a beautiful drawing. She looked at it. She said, oh, Mr. Picasso, fantastic. She starts walking away. He goes, my dear lady, that'll be $1 million. She said, Mr. Picasso, $1 million. It took you 30 seconds to do that. He said, my dear lady, it took me 30 years to do that in 30 seconds. When we look at the Bonos of the world, when we look at the leading sales professions of the world, when we look at the best leaders without title, when we look at the masters of HR, the masters of R&D, we look at the best business people, we say, she's gifted, she's smarter than me, she's better with people than me, she just somehow knows more than me, she's got a better education, she had an easier background, she got lucky. You've heard the cliche because it's true, the harder I work, the luckier I get. I'm here today. I'm an ordinary person, but I focused on my craft. I had a burning desire to be excellent. I love what I do. What I do, this leadership message, sharing in my books and speaking is my oxygen. It's my DNA. 4 a.m. I get up and I'm working on my craft because I love it. I love it. I think I know every single one of us can be a genius quicker than you think. Quicker than you think. But if you focus on all things, then to be all things to all people, you can never really get to mastery or specialty. So be stunningly good at what you do on this first big idea of leading without title. Secondly, and by the way, you know, I have found that there's a lot of stress in our world. Would anyone agree with me there's a lot of stress in our world? And sometimes when we become under stress or we're busy being busy, we forget about focusing on what's most important. If I may, allow me to share with you one of my favorite stories on stress. I was in a grocery store a little while ago, and I saw a mother pushing her baby. And this baby was crying, screaming like you can't imagine. And I overheard the mother saying, "Don't scream, Jennifer. Don't yell, Jennifer. Be calm, Jennifer." So friends, I couldn't help myself. I walked over to this woman. I said, "Madam, I can't tell you how impressed I am by the way you're speaking to your baby." And she looks at me and she says, "No, I'm Jennifer." Ladies and gentlemen, every time you blame your background, every time you blame your boss, every time you blame your clients, every time you blame the culture, you're literally giving away your power to influence. You are giving away your power to be the change you want to see in the world, as Gandhi said. I think it's an impotent way to live to say it's because of other people and it's because of circumstances that I'm not playing my best game. My life changed when I realized a simple idea, which is life is a mirror. And life gives us not what we want. Life gives us who we are. And it's amazing what happens as you walk out in the world and as you begin to take responsibility for leading without title, for adding more value, for inspiring people more, for innovating where you're planted, for building relationships, for being the nicest person that you know. What begins to happen through an organization and through your life? Absolute personal responsibility. Fourth point, become outrageously enthusiastic. And again, you're going to say, Robin, let's hold hands and sing Kumbaya. You know, being enthusiastic isn't important. Next thing you're going to tell me is get up in the morning and look in the mirror and saying, I think I am. I like myself. But isn't it true that the most enthusiastic person in the room influences people? And they elevate people, and they encourage people. Another issue of Fortune magazine a little while ago did a story on Richard Branson's Necker Island conference. He invited all sorts of amazing people. And the reporter in the room said something I've never forgotten. The reporter said, it was striking to me how in each of the conference sessions, the moguls of these giant firms were always the most enthusiastic people in the rooms. It's amazing to me when I meet world-class CEOs. They are the most humble, the most passionate, they are the most engaged, they are the most lively people in the room. I think it's fundamentally important to be the most enthusiastic person you know. I think in so many ways, leadership is about inspiring people by your example. And children are masters of this. Children know these fundamentals. Just a little point on how children remember the simple things. My son Colby is 13. He turned 13 a few months ago. And I believe a child only turns 13 once. So I wanted to create an unbelievable experience for my son Colby. And I'm going to do the same for Bianca when she turns 13. So I decided to take Colby to New York. And I wanted to do an amazing, amazing weekend for Colby. So we had food at my favorite restaurant. We stayed at my favorite hotel. We went to FAO Schwartz. We went to the Play Wicked. It was absolutely incredible. That night, Sunday night, on the way home on the airplane, I said to Colby, what was the most unforgettable thing about our weekend together? A special father and son weekend. You know what he said to me? He said, Dad, on Saturday afternoon when we were sharing that simple pastry on the street, talking and laughing, he said, Dad, that was my favorite moment. It's the simple things that are essential to leadership, the simple things that are essential to life. Be the most enthusiastic person you know. And then the final tactic, give the extra 1%. Leadership doesn't happen when things are easy. Leadership is about how you show up when everyone else feels like going home at the end of the day. Leadership occurs on the extra mile. Leadership occurs when everyone has laughed at your idea. Leadership occurs when you feel like giving up and you reach into yourself and you pull out what Carmichael, who is Lance Armstrong's coach, said, the final 1%. He said what made Lance Armstrong great was everyone else gave up at the end, but he kept that final 1% in reserve. And when everyone else was exhausted and everyone else felt like giving up, Lance Armstrong reached deep within, and that final 1% is what made him world class.